My name is Dean Callan, as you can see by the Dean Callan Show. I'm currently in the process of trying to get my own bar, which I have been in the process of since I was like 14 years old. And the more I look at it, the more I realize I do kind of want to take my time, but also I've never done it before, so it's going to take me a long time. In the interim period, I plan to go and do guest shifts and call it the Dean Callan Show and try to be as extravagant as I can to kind of be like, don't forget about me, you know, since I've left my previous job and I'm not actually working. Does that make sense? Now, the last year, I really haven't been working. I've been doing a year of self-discovery. I've been working previously since I was like 14 years old, full-time. And I was super stressed out. I worked all the time. And I realized that actually taking some time off was really nice. I got married, changed my life priorities, started hanging out in my back garden, drinking pina coladas and relaxing. I grew some grapes. I was gonna make one bottle of wine, but the squirrels ate all the grapes. So I failed at my wine. Maybe next year. This is all my social media. Not that it makes that big a difference. I'm kind of like capped on everything anyway, apart from Instagram. Now, the presentation today, I wanted to talk about, obviously, if you've seen the cover, the description, it really doesn't relay any of what I'm about to talk about. It was kind of off the cuff last minute. But I wanted to start by saying, when I first started bartending, the only bartenders you could really follow were flair bartenders, and my heroes were Christian Delpech and Nicolas Saint-Jean, or you could follow the legendary mixologists like Charles Schumann and Dale DeGroff, or you could just work in a pub and not be concerned about being famous. I don't know who this guy is. I Googled bartender old man's pub, right? Now, last week something happened to me. In all of my experience, I've always been able very easily to rationalize stuff. Like even when I was a junior bartender and I really didn't know what I was doing, I thought I knew what I was doing. So that subconscious incompetence protected me from having like Morty's mind blower moments where I just couldn't wrap my head around something. But after 17, almost 18 years in the industry, last week I had a little moment where I was like, I just don't get it. Am I getting old? Like, I passed my sell-by date and I'm about to open a bar. And I wanted to use this forum because it is a relaxed forum and it is about hospitality and we're all caring people here because we're here because we care. To take the opportunity to take something that I've seen on the internet that I wanted to comment on and start a discussion with and bring it into real life, put my logic together, and then I'm open for you guys to be like, Dean, you're fucking wrong, okay? And I'm gonna be able to cope with that. I have coping mechanisms built into my personality. I'm a rounded individual. Does that make sense? Okay, and we can have a real discussion because I can't comment on Facebook because it's just negative, 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 and I don't even know these people. They're not in the room. So I'm going to show you the video that started the whole train of thought. It's not going to work straight away. Nope, at all. Even. Wait, there we go. Reset. So if you're familiar with Cocktails for You, it's a really big platform. Like they put a video up, it gets 50,000 views and stuff like that. A lot of people share their opinions. But this one video, I'm not gonna give you the context. I want you to get your own personal reaction from the video and then we'll talk about it.
Oh!
Pina colada. Note, he's filled the shaker for the two daiquiris and let it sit there cooking a little bit.
It's really wet ice.
Okay, right, so it looks like fun, right? Like, all the comments on the video were super, super negative. Like, I'm like, guys, seriously, what's going on? Which kind of, I don't understand. A few people were like, I think he's pretty good. It's okay, definitely. But like, I think he's pretty good, but it's definitely possible to beat him. I was like, yeah, it probably is. But I mean, is that you? Like, and there was all these different comments, and I can understand, like, definitely possible to beat him. Like, it looks much easier. I've done it. It's not as easy as it looks. And also the judges. You've got Ian Burrell there. Has anyone ever heard of Ian Burrell? Yeah. And these are rum drinks. Like, it would ruin his reputation if he just flat out let you get away with whatever you wanted. Do you know? So a lot of people get knocked down. And without knowing the competition, or without knowing, more importantly, what was inside those black glass bottles? You can't say that all those drinks taste shit. They could have all the bottles could have had one giant pre-prep of delicious cocktail, and he's just mocking the whole thing for all we know, really. So from my experience, I'm like, I don't understand how people could just flat say this is shit or that's disgusting. I understand if it's not your style. But my training, my bartending experience taught me, if you're gonna give criticism, give constructive criticism, and we're here to build things. We're here to build communities. We're here to build confidence and an evening, an experience for our guests. And we're here to build drinks. He can clearly build drinks. One guy posted a link to Difford's guide, How to Shake a Cocktail, for Stuart Hudson. The guy 10 years ago was working at Milk and Honey. You know what I mean? When it was really good. Like, it's good now, but I mean, when it was the cutting edge, kind of, no one else had caught up to that yet. He was there. Like, and he's been there since, constantly at a very good quality. He has great knowledge. I just couldn't understand it. But the one thing I couldn't understand the most was one of the comments was, this basically, one of them said white trash, and then it said, like, I thought you guys at Cocktails for You, I thought you would understand that mixology is art. And I was like, whoa, okay. Now, is this person just trying to be really deep, or is there something I'm missing? And for the last 10 years, I've traveled all around the world, drank cocktails in lots of really amazing bars, and I'm still couldn't figure out mixology as art. What does that mean? Is it visual art? Is it performance art? Did you see what I did there? And what is more important? So I thought I would pose that question to the whole room, and I would give you, because you might be shy, my take on what I did when I asked myself that question last week. Does that make sense? Cool. First thing I did was I Googled cocktails as art. We'll get to that later. The second thing I did was I Googled world's best bartender and I Googled world's best cocktail. Now, it's really interesting, the world's best bartender, if you look at Google and you look at what pops up, it's going to be the things that people most click on, unless you've got like a company you've paid to ensure that through search engine optimization, when someone Googles world's best bartender or world's best bar, you come up, which is what world's 10 best bartenders has done with the spirits business. You know, you can see that's a separate thing, and then it comes to the next slot. Then it's the main stuff. So the spirits business has done a great job to put Ryan Chetty, who is an amazing bartender, up the top. But then you've just got all flair shows. So to my understanding, that means that the general public believe that the show that they see behind the bar dictates whether this is a good bartender or a bad bartender. Does that make sense? Then, looking at the cocktails, I went through, and you can see here, I clicked on 25 best-selling cocktails in the world by Business Insider and started looking at what were the best-selling cocktails, because we're in the business of bars. So obviously the best cocktails in the world are the ones that the top 50 or top 100 bars in the world are selling the most of. They've got to be the best. Does that make sense? Like, if you're winning at the Olympics, you are the best. It's not like, oh yeah, but my mate down the road didn't enter. He could have beaten Usain Bolt. I've seen him run. It's pretty definitive. That's that. Now you've quantified it. You know that person won. So then I pulled it back and just delved right into the performing arts. So for me personally, if I go to a bar and I get a fantastic cocktail that looks like I want to take a photo of it, maybe these guys are going to be super amazing on Instagram, and I really don't understand how it was even made, I'll be super amazed by it. But anyone that knows me knows I like to sit at the bar. So my personal preference is watching the bartenders bartend. I get taken away by, like, you see a really cool cut and you're like, oh, look at the cut. And you see him shake and you're like, oh, I don't like that shake. He's doing the Charlie Chaplin shake or whatever, which we'll get to later. But you, for me, that is the entertainment. That's the art. It's a performance. And the cocktail is effectively a prop in the larger performance. I'm there to have a night out. I want to see things. I want to have fun. If I'm there to have a meeting with someone, or I'm there with my wife and I don't want to be disturbed, which very often doesn't happen, I'll stay at home. I have a bar at my house, specifically for nights when I don't want to be disturbed and I want a nice drink. I'll sit at a table and the drinks will come out and it'll be amazing, but I feel like I'm missing part of the performance. I feel like I'm missing part of the whole drink experience. So for me, I started with performing arts. And to be honest, like, my understanding of performance as far as cocktails was concerned, given the time I've been in the industry, was flair. And the biggest shared or most obvious flair videos I could find were these ones. Which, straight away, right? Okay. No one's gonna get upset if I stop it there. Right? So I love it. I think it's amazing. Like, I would like to be as good at flair as he is. But again, this is a performance and it's just taking it right out of the bar and making it a pure onstage performance. And if you Google world's best bartender and that's what comes up, when you know, if you're 16 years old and you wanna be a bartender and you're like, your nature, having grown up through your entire life with Google, is to Google stuff to get some information back on, you know, what is good. So for me, like, these guys pop up all the time, and it's because to the masses, to the 99.9% who drink in bars, like, they're not going to the world's 50 best bars. There are so many hundreds of thousands of bars out there where people don't know about the world's 50 best bars. They've never heard of Dandelion. They've never heard of the American bar at the Savoy. So to them, bartending is at its very core, it's very basic. Does that make sense? Now, would anyone in this room, at this point in their career, convert to picking up a flare bottle and practicing flare a couple of hours a day to build up their base as a serious response question? Okay.
Yeah, man. I just want to say, you know, I know people who make flare, you know, and this guy, you know, he looks like he has, like, stupid how he looks and his shoes. I tell you, this guy for sure trains like 12
I know.
12 hours per day.
Well, one of the things,
it's pretty tough.
I know.
To do what he's doing.
So, one of the things I wanted to say in defense of that, because for me personally, like I said, when I first started bartending, my heroes were Nicolas Saint-Jean and Christian Delpech. You know, when I first started getting really into bartending. So I used to have in my back garden, I built a wooden bar and I had plastic flare bottles and I would stand out and flare a couple of hours a day. Now, I couldn't Google or get a hold of as much information in those days as you can now. I would literally post things on Drink Boy and go inside after half an hour of flair and check whether anyone had got back to me on Drink Boy and on eGullet and other forums because there was no Facebook. And that training, I think to me, has helped me throughout my entire career. To the point now, I haven't bartended for a long time, and when I'm bartending, I'm picking up the bottle and I know I want to pour like I used to, but my arm just isn't as flexible as it used to be. I used to be quite bang, it would be dead straight. The pour would stay dead straight. I'd cut, it would drop straight because I had that hand-eye coordination, which if you look at it, when you're pouring, when you're using a shaker, your cut is the same cut. And in mixology, like if you see the great guys to watch, like your Maron Beckes and your Simone Caporales, like their cuts on their from their shake to strain to pour, whatever, are beautiful. But that comes from flare training. And for me, I think the craft needs to kind of look at this performance side and see which elements it can take and apply to the visual or the service, the hospitality side. And for me, having gone back and looked at it, I was like, oh man, I used to be so much more flexible. And I picked up a flare bottle and started throwing stuff around. And I was trying to do stuff, and I just, to actually shadow from down the bottom of here and have it flip around and catch it, you need to be quite flexible because you can't move your whole body or you look shit. You have to make it look like it's a tiny little thing, and you need all the little muscles in here. You need to be able to catch it. So I decided, rather than use it at work, I might start working on a flare routine that loops constantly. Starts with just around my hand, like a circle eight, and then I'm flicking it and catching it and flicking it and catching it and passing it amongst hands until I'm doing a full movement and use it as a warm-up before I jump behind the bar, like kind of bartender yoga. And it's gonna get my hands quick, it's gonna get my pores and cuts more accurate, it's gonna make me quicker, and like the feel of picking up a bottle when you're trained flair is totally different. You see some guys, even 5-6 years in, they're picking up the bottle and they're like super rigid with it. If you've seen someone that's flared a lot, they're just touching it with a couple of fingers and they've got more freedom of movement. So I decided that would work. Like, does that sound stupid? All right, because I'm gonna go sharing that with people. So as a forum, I'm cool with that. Doesn't sound stupid. You can tell me it's stupid, it's okay. No? All right. So moving on to the next thing. This is one of the most famous flair bartenders in the world, especially back in the Christian Delpech, Nicolas Saint-Jean day, bartending behind a bar with the flair. Oh, whoops. If it works. I'm not gonna play the whole video, but you'll see the reaction of the customers and like how much energy he's actually putting in. And I love the personality. You can see his personality coming out. Obviously, you need to pick your demographic.
Thank you.
Now, the drink he's physically making right now is clearly not an art piece. If you look at the vessels he's putting drinks into, they're all plastic and they're all horrible. And he's not actually focused on the drink at all. He's just focused on everything else but the drink. He makes you look away from the horrible plastic hurricane tube thing, which might even be a benefit, but he doesn't stop all day. This guy's like this all day. He's putting a lot of energy out there. And they're drinking Red Bulls and stuff. So, oh, there you go, plastic cups. So, obviously in the bar when I open, that's not my demographic. And that's not, in my opinion, like, mixology as art, or cocktails or bartending as art at all. So it's, that's going right down to the absurd level of looking at it from that point of view. But those guys have inspired bartenders of today who are now super well respected and super renowned by the very people who were giving the negativity towards flair and the negativity towards guys they've never even met. So for looking at that, there's a lot of elements of what he does that you can see now in today's bartenders. And this guy as well, has anyone ever seen this video before? Charlie Chaplin making cocktails? Yeah, obviously. Now, I'm not going to say who it is, but if it reminds you of anyone, like, shout it out and I'll give you a shot. Okay? Oh, whoops. Straight away. Yeah. Do you know the good thing about this is though? Like, you could say that Marion has copied this style, or he's a master of what he does. But Charlie Chaplin was doing observational humor, which means that he was taking what was happening behind bars at that time and then over-exaggerating it to turn it into comedy. If you look at it from that point of view, he doesn't shake the shaker, he shakes himself. I love it! I wish I could do that. But if you look at what he's doing, like, now you have to assume that he's probably making a Tom and Jerry or something like that, because he adds hot water to it, he puts a whole egg in, but some sort of flip. But he's captured what the bartending, the over-the-top, ridiculous bartending style of the 1920s, 1930s, whatever it was actually like, because he's doing observational humor. So we can capture, kind of get a sense of what bartenders in those days, you know, what their movements were like and what they were doing, because he's, although kind of over-accentuating it, he's captured it. So I think that is amazing. And you wouldn't really want to go to that level behind a bar unless you can shake your entire body without shaking the cocktail shaker, which would be amazing. But I think that's great for that reason. And I've forgotten all about this video, and I'd forgotten about kind of my old flair days and stuff like that. And that post made me go back to them. And you guys have already seen this, so it's kind of like preaching to the converted. Now, when I started looking at art, like visual arts with cocktails, at first I tried to find like a kind of distant, I don't know anything about art. I tried to find something out on the fringes that wasn't blatantly taking art and applying it to cocktails. But I didn't know enough about actual visual art. I don't go to museums very often. And if I do, I just find the bit I like. I don't even remember which artist it was. I was like, ooh, I like that one. You know, it's very subjective for me. I'm not trying to be an academic in that at all. This is one of my favorite things, because I've actually like been to Venice and I got one of the sunsets. It actually was like colors like that, and it made me really, it was really impactful that to think that he kind of captured the emotion that I had when I was sat there drinking Negronis all day. But I found some very literal translations, and some of the ones that I found most interesting, I captured, and then tried to figure out, you know, could I do those in my bar? And this one, absolutely cannot do that. I looked into it. It takes, he only had it on the menu for a short time. Has everyone seen this before?
Yes.
Yeah, he only had it on the menu for a short time and it took him like 15 minutes to do each one. Now, for me, I don't even know how he stabilized the foam to stay there exactly like that for 15 minutes. So, like, I'd love to ask him, I'd love to meet him. I think it's absolutely beautiful. And the fact that he painted those himself with edible ink is phenomenal. Like, it blew me away. It started to re-inspire me again. And kind of made me want to do something like that for my guests and pay tribute to the guys in Hong Kong who'd come up with this. It was at the Artesian in Hong Kong. And that made me look up the other stuff that he'd done. His name's Rajendra Limbu from the Artesian in Hong Kong. Everyone calls him Rush, I think it was. And I learned about this artist because I fell in love with the look of that cocktail. And that to me, kind of, at first I was like, I would never have that in my bar. But then because it had inspired me to look into things that I hadn't previously considered important in my life or hadn't really looked into, I'm now reconsidering that. So where previously I was all performing arts and I didn't really care for visual arts, I'm a guy that likes a clover club because it's got that nice contrast of pink and white, but I don't like over the top garnishes on the top of it. I don't, dehydrated or freeze dried raspberries on the top with like cool little things. I'm like, nah. In fact, I used to drink clover clubs all the time, and the best clover club I ever had was served to me by a guy called Gregor de Geyther in 2009. And it was so good that I now haven't drank one since, so I can kind of try to remember what it tasted like and try to recreate it when I open my own bar to try to get that flavor, that balance. But I doubt I'll ever quite get it as good as my memory because it keeps getting better in my memory all the time. This one as well, absolutely amazing. There's a video of him, I'm not gonna play it today. There's a video of him painting that. Again, I absolutely love it, but I don't know if I'd be able to pull that off in my own bar. I want a volume bar, and you know, if it's limited edition, it'll be great for PR, but obviously I can't paint on the top of foam like that. So it kind of didn't really, there's not much I could do with it. And obviously this one, amazing again. Then I seen this, and I was like, wow, you can do it with cappuccinos. How did you keep it warm while you painted that on? Well, actually, the truth of the story is, he doesn't keep it warm. He's a barista from Seoul, and he makes a cold coffee, and then puts a cold, like really heavy foam on the top of it that won't destabilize, and it takes him over an hour to paint each one. And he only does three a day, so you have to kind of book it in. Which, and I know it's not cocktails, but that's about as close to just an art piece in drink form that I could find. And that's where I was like, right, I've gone a little bit too far down the rabbit hole now on the visual arts thing. And I remembered, again, over in Asia, but in Hong Kong, back to Hong Kong again this time, Simone's. Has everyone seen this?
Yeah.
Everyone's seen everything, right?
With rice paper.
With rice paper, yeah. So this, I found that stunning, and obviously I can like print whatever I want on the top of that. Like, I could find a news article I found relevant, like the latest dumb shit Trump said in a tweet, and print it and just put it on the top of a cocktail. So someone's like, oh, the journalist cocktail comes with it. Do you know what I mean? Like with a piece of paper on the side, which I thought would be kind of cool. But this I could actually do. So I'd seen that, thought it was cool, moved on, kind of forgotten about it, like let it be his thing, whatever. But that kind of going out and trying to find a positive from that, you know, mixology is art thing, which kind of made me feel a bit sick in the stomach at first, has actually led me to, yeah, it's £129 for a Canon 7225, whatever printer with a whole six different cartridges of printable ink and 50 sheets of rice paper. I can afford £130. I can just have that printer just for printing edible stuff onto cocktails for my home bar. So now I'm getting one. It's inspired me. and I'm going to see what I can do and pay homage to the guy that inspired me to do it, if that makes sense. It's a nice way to share that story. Has anyone else thought about doing this? Nope? Just not interested? I thought it was cool. Anyway, right, I could be wrong on that one. Just leave it to them, right? Nope? You're just going quiet now, you just want to leave. Sav's falling asleep. Then I thought, right, who today kind of captures a little bit of both? They've got that showmanship, that kind of the style that you would expect coming from Flair, and they've got the artistry in the masterful, beautiful looking drinks. Dennis. And what's that?
Dennis.
I don't know. I will look him up though after this, sorry. But these two boys for me, because I've spent loads of time around them, I used to work with Luca back in the day, and Marion, I've sat at his bars loads. Even when he was at Nightjar, I got to actually sit at the bar, which was pretty cool. I'm all excitable, try not to talk to him too much. This is his drinks cabinet in his toilet at home. I'm not even joking. Those two guys, I thought, embodied that. As far as modern mixology and having that flair aspect integrated into it. So I've taken a look at some of the drinks that they've done, which I think are absolutely spectacular. Again, like I might have tried if I was able to, if I fell in love with it, to recreate that, but those two would just be too time consuming for me, for my bar. What's that?
I saw they were talking about what they were doing in Nitro when they worked together, and they had like people who were there just to make the garnishes.
Mm.
Everything was mezzanotte. They were having from everything, all the glasses. So everything they were saying that they were selling like 400, 500 drinks at the Nitro.
Oh yeah, I agree with that 100%. But when you think about when I think about a museum. And I think about people that come to look at beautiful things, they're very different to me. I have a very short attention span, and I'll look at something, absorb it, and move on. So, and when I go to Nightjar, I love Nightjar, but I'm a cocktail geek, and I love Nightjar because I'm a cocktail geek, and I geek out on the cocktails, and I geek out watching them. I think they're amazing to watch. But when I open my own bar, I want to fill it with people that are my type of demographic. And my type of demographic don't have any money, and they're going to be a bit more impatient. And I myself don't really have the discipline. I become impatient quite quickly. I'm more of a like stick to my classics that I know and try to make the atmosphere as much fun as I possibly can, and keep that energy up. Otherwise, I'll get bored, and then my service standards will drop. So I have to kind of, I would love to work towards that. But I could never pull it off. I just do not have the discipline. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Yeah. And also, I probably wouldn't have the patience to train this, to learn it and then train the staff how to do it constantly. It's one of the big issues I'm facing at the moment, trying to figure out how do I train an 18-year-old bartender from zero to being capable of holding the bar, the point bar, by himself in 6 months in 7 years from now. That in 7 years from now, that 18-year-old, even if I open my bar today, is currently 11. And they're teaching math differently in school. People are learning on iPads. Remember, I had a book that I had to write on. You know, by the time they come around to meeting me and they're 18 and I start training them, the way they have learned for the past 20 years is going to be completely different to the way I have been taught to teach. Does that make sense? So, yeah, I have to try to keep it real to me. At the same time, though, I love watching this. So this, I found this video today because it's quite new, kind of encompassed better what I was even talking about in this presentation, what I meant to talk about, than I could have possibly done, if it works. Come on. You can do it. It's not doing that, is it? Technology. your best friend until it's not. Where's the previously viewed? I am gonna try to find it really quickly for you guys. Here we go. So to me, I already want to go drink in his bar straight away. But I absolutely fell in love with that. Because you had the combination of the show with an amazing looking drink. And his drinks, although they're quite challenging, they're kind of delicious, right? Has everyone been to Gibson? No, you haven't been?
I've never been to Gibson, but I and Vicky give a Campari workshop to our company. Some bartenders, and he's very clever as well.
Yeah.
He mixed the Americano, the coffee, and the drink. Very clever. He took like an Nespresso coffee machine and put instead of water Campari in the machine. And so we had an Americano. Yeah. And so it's very clever what he's doing. He had like a lot of very easy ideas how to build a new inspiration into a drink.
Yeah, he's a genius. He's awesome. So he's obviously inspirational, and in the same respect, very similar style. They obviously work together to develop it. But I love these City Space videos. They're amazing. Well, the old ones, anyway. So, Luca, you've got a different personality. Well, it's kind of similar, but you can see he's doing the same thing. Thank you. I do remember the video being shorter. It's probably more excited last time. So for me, if that came to my table, I'd be super impressed, but getting to watch the whole process is just that extra bit better. Like, I'm more of a process guy. I like the whole functional aspect of it. And then I went back to revisit one of my favorite bars of all time. And it was my favorite, it was one of my favorite bars, not because the drinks came out looking fantastic, but because when I went in there, I knew the bartenders. They always greeted me with a smile, often with a glass of champagne. They always had an upbeat energy. And despite it being in a five-star hotel bar, they knew how to party. And if you look at the next video, I've got Simone in it. I'll cut it real quick so we can get back to the discussion bit as quick as possible. But he, you can see in him, he's the type of bartender that I feel you could throw him into a five deep nightclub bar where all he's making is, you know, whiskey colas and gin and tonics and vodka sodas or whatever, and he would just bust them out. He wouldn't drop an attitude and be like, oh, this place is a shithole, like this ice is not good enough for me to bartend with. You know, he's got that depth of character and that flex. So these videos, obviously, they're getting quite similar. But you can straight away, those little, that Flippy was doing that back in Vegas. They're exactly the same moves as the other flair guys were using earlier on. And we're just on 10 minutes. I'm gonna go back to the discussion. So for me, what I ended up with, that process, obviously I took that comment and I wanted to respond to it. And I wanted to kind of get shitty and get angry and do what everyone else does on Facebook or any social media where it's the easiest thing is to be a bit negative. And I usually am quite positive and like try to build things. And I found first, they were commenting about Stuart Hudson, who's a good friend of mine, so obviously I had an emotional connection to it. Secondly, I felt like they didn't have the right to be commenting the way they were if they hadn't really earned their stripes. And third, I really didn't feel they gave a balanced argument. They, you know, why, what were they even saying? And then I realized that upon looking back on all of the different things and knowing the guys, first of all, having seen this stuff in real life, having been to all of these bars, having tasted their drinks, having seen them in person, actually executing those moves, it gives me a more rounded respect for what's going on. And if you're looking at Facebook and you're looking at these comments, like for me at first on face value, like mixology is art. I was just like, what? I thought maybe I'm about to open my own bar and this is what 90% of the public coming into top-end cocktail bars are looking for. They want mixology as art. I didn't even get it. It's not my scene, so I started to feel insecure. And because I started to feel insecure, I wanted to kind of lash back at this person. And if you look at that video and not really understanding what's going on, why they're just throwing things into a shaker, or it might be perceived that way, it looks like those drinks aren't going to be great because you really don't know what's going into them. You're missing something and you really don't have much to say. You can't really comment, you can't be positive, you can't praise, and you're going to feel that same insecurities. So you're missing the balance. And that made me kind of feel a lot better about it. And I thought, right, I'm going to share that process of how I got round to being positive again and see whether or not I'm just totally full of shit. and I've been like tripping too much and reading too much, or if that actually helps and other people feel the same way. Because on Facebook, you say something negative and then you're putting pressure on the person after to either join that peer pressure group and say something negative, or if everybody said something positive and you're that only person that said something negative, you get more attention. And maybe the people that are doing that need some more attention in their lives. They're not feeling 100% confident with themselves. Does that make sense? Yeah, is there anyone out there? So, sorry I spoke the whole time, but is there anyone, do you guys feel like that's a just breakdown of that whole process, or would you say that I'm missing a beat still?
Yeah, big man? We are always comfortable to judge without knowing, so I think that, you know, many people are don't have experience and they don't look at the funnels. Look, for instance, I'm living here in Germany, you know, and when Trump was elected in America, you know, it doesn't have nothing to do at the moment with Germany, you know, everybody was talking, all my Facebook list, you know, I'm coming originally from Romania, all my Facebook list, friends from Romania were talking, hey, Donald Trump was elected, you know, they don't know shit about it, you know, just what's going on in propaganda, you know.
Yeah.
So this is the human nature, so to discuss and
to show that they've got some sort of opinion.
Yeah.
I've always felt, yeah, I know where my position is on that, but that one thing kind of threw me a little bit. So I thought I'd take the opportunity to vent it a little bit and see what you guys thought. But then again, it's kind of hard to speak out in a crowd. Thank you very much. Craig, nothing?
I think that if those people are trolls, then they're somewhat sad people, you know, like, I know you, for instance, so if you're posting something, I respect you, and there's a common respect among people that we know in this industry and what they do, and, you know, like, the anti-waste, you know, tiki thing and all that stuff, people talk shit, they, oh, you fly all over and you do this shit, and how's that, you know, like, fuck you. You know, like, they're creating a whole discussion based around the subject. It's great. It's expanding consciousness. Like, there's a real benefit going on here. Somebody's sitting there in their underwear, they just got them jacking off, and now they're going to talk shit about what somebody's done. It's like a rematch that's not about precision. You know, this is fun. You know, like, it's fun.
Yeah.
And so, like, I just don't even give those people a second look. It's just, they're not anywhere in my peer group. They're sad people, and that just don't bother me. But if you could share 5 minutes with them, like if they were in this room,
that's it. Yeah.
By the end of it, they would be like, "Yeah, I was a dick that one time, but you know, like I fight my girlfriend."
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Okay. Well, I guess everyone's getting a bit tired now. It's time to go out and party. So, if there's any questions or if anyone wants to make a comment,
what are you doing, bro? Making sure the problem.
Just think, I was nervous. And when I get nervous...
I see.
Would you like some? I don't have glasses or other ingredients. I'm the budget speaker. I asked for some paper cups and they were like, look, we don't have enough to be given you paper cups. But if you'd like a layback, if the cameras have stopped rolling, we can pass it around. Anyone? No? Have you tasted this stuff? It's delicious. Watch, look. It's really good. I used to be the guy that drank the most monkey shoulder in the world, and I knew that absolutely without a shadow of a doubt. And now that's slipping a little bit. I'm still drinking monkey shoulder, but not at the pace I was before. So when I get the opportunity.
And Ukraine, you made an old-fashioned on stage during your speech.
Oh, yeah, yeah. No, do you know that? I was just like, do you know what's really interesting about that? I flew over to... on behalf of Monkey Shoulder Ukraine to do the presentation, but no one, I thought they'd told the global team that I was going on, and they hadn't. That would be nice to cut out, that no one knew. No one knew, so, and it didn't look, when I first got there, it didn't look like, you know, if someone flies you over, you pay the respect back, it's a win-win thing. So I was like, can you get me a bottle of Monkey Shoulder, what for? I was just going to make myself a drink on stage. Oh, you can make everyone a drink. I was like, no, just can you please get me one? And they brought the point of sale up, like the gadgets.
The really sweet part was like when you were like sitting and your microphone was like inside the glass. And like,
Really? Could you hear that? Oh, okay, I didn't know that. Yeah. That's bad. Yeah, it helps you stay relaxed. And it also gives you something to do if, I call it an anchor. Like if you've got something you can go back to that grounds you again, like people. Like I picked on you two and Zav, because I know that you're going to be okay with it. Yeah, and it looks like crowd interaction. Right? Okay, cool. So if everyone's cool, thank you for coming. It's been nice. Yeah, that's...